Spirit of God is alive and present in this place, and you, my friends, are the body of Christ for this time and for this place. A very special welcome to worship at Trinity United Church, Beamsville, to those who have gathered here this morning and to those who are listening to us online. We woke up this morning to a wintry wonderland, somewhat chilly and lots of snow, just the kind of day when you wish when the service was over you could have a really nice bowl of hot soup. Well, it's your lucky day, because following our meeting today, there's soup downstairs if you couldn't smell it when you came in. So please join us following our annual meeting. And as you know, that's going to happen, so you just remain in the sanctuary at the end of the service. Again, a most welcome to this time of worshiping together.
Seen here are beautiful, vibrant pictures of dancing at a powwow in Six Nations of the Grand River. Anishinaabe, Odawandaron, and Haudenosaunee Indigenous people are part of the Six Nations community of the First Nations Confederacy. First Nations, Métis, and Inuit music and dance embody cultural identity. First Nations people have songs for grieving, for birth, for joy, for prayer, and for so many other significant ceremonies and events. Singers, drummers, and ceremonial people are treated with respect and honor for their gift of song. First Nations music and dance were outlawed in Canada by the Indian Act of 1876 as a tool of forced assimilation and cultural destruction. As a result, First Nations, Métis, and Inuit music and dance went underground for many years. Anishinaabe, Odawandaron, and Haudenosaunee Indigenous people lived here and still live here under the Wampum Treaty of One Dish, One Spoon. They too have ceremonies for significant events in their lives. They strive to share their culture with Indigenous people and with others. Indigenous people receive from their elders a deep and rich understanding of creation and of the mystery that surrounds us all. Yet, when they try to share their vision, settlers often chose not to hear, trying to force Indigenous peoples to be like them. And in doing so, the vision that made the Indigenous who they were was damaged and destroyed. Our denomination, the United Church of Canada, as well as other denominations, are in the midst of a long and painful journey as we reflect on the cries that our churches did not or would not hear, and on how we have behaved as churches. Awareness of the hurt suffered in Indigenous communities is part of the painful journey of truth, reconciliation, repentance, and healing that we travel in the quest to overcome colonization, racism, and injustice. We pray that all Indigenous people will hear the sincerity of our words today and that they will witness the living out of our apology in our actions in the future.
Oh, please. We wait in the darkness of unknowing for the light that can never be put out, the light that takes away all the dimness of our souls.
We wait for the Christ, the one who is the light of all.
Let us prepare our hearts as we wait for the Christ who comes in love. With joy, let us worship God who enlightens our lives. Please join us in this all-inclusive prayer. Holy One, on this third Sunday of Advent, let us remember that the good news of Jesus' birth has the power to bring us great joy this Christmas season. Our joy is not dependent on what is going on in our life, our world, or the people we are with. It doesn't depend on the gifts we give or find under the tree. No earthly thing gives us complete joy. Our joy comes from you. That same joy which flooded the hearts of the shepherds, the angels, the wise men, the host of heaven, and Mary and Joseph, still has the power to overwhelm our hearts with rejoicing. May it be so. Amen.
beginning was the chaos of trouble and fear. Then, when uncertainty became the only certain thing, and the light at the end of the tunnel turned out to be just our imaginations, God said, "Let there be light." And with hope.
In the course of time, people became agitated, and there was no space for quietness. Then, when the agitation was at its height, when it seemed that conflict and noise were everywhere, God said, "Let there be light."
And there was peace.
And then came a time when people had learned not to care. Hate and anger seemed to rule the hearts of people, and so it was that people forgot how to laugh. There was gloom and deep sadness and fear. Happiness was pursued in the accumulation of things and people paid to be happy. The words joy and contentment were replaced by me and mine. When the smiles seemed to have been forgotten, frowns and scowls seemed normal, and the shadows of gloom were almost tangible. God said, "Let there be light."
And there was joy.
Thank you. the people who walk in darkness, the people who shout will see a great light, the people who live in the valley of death, light will come to you.
I'll invite any other young people as well who want to join us to come here. I don't know whether there's anyone else or not. My faithful group. Well, we need to start, we need to start with finding out where our characters are for the creche. Oh, already knows. Where?
Mary and Joseph
made it over there. Yeah, they're around the other side of the pulpit there. They got closer. Where are the wise men? No, they're not over there. Yeah, they're way back at the back there. I think. See them on that side, folks? Oh? Ah, back in the far corner back there. So they're getting closer, but remember, they had the longest way to come to get to Bethlehem. And where are the shepherds? Are the shepherds in the same place as they were last week?
No.
You think so? Actually, they're not. How many of you noticed that they're not in the same place? Ain't nobody there. But you know what happened? The grass got too short on that side of the table. So they had to move to this side of the table for better grass for the sheep. Anyway, all of them are on their way Next week, they'll probably be at the stable in Bethlehem. So we'll have to wait and see what happens then. So, you folks lit the joy candle this morning. And joy is a big part, I think, of Christmas. We have the wonderful, joyous story of Mary and Joseph and the wise men and the shepherds. A great and wonderful story that brings joy to all of us at this time of the year. But there are other signs of Christmas. Can you think of any other signs you see about Christmas around you? Presents, yes, that's true, but my tie. Okay, thank you. I was thinking more out there. Have you seen anything out there that reminds you that we're in the Christmas season? Snow?
Floods?
Yes. I was thinking of something more obvious. Pardon?
Tree? The Christmas tree?
And what's on the Christmas trees?
Ornaments.
And?
Lights,
yes. There's all kinds of lights out there, aren't there? If you look at our downtown street, it's just gorgeous with the lights that are there. Because lights is such a very important part of Christmas. Jesus was born to bring light to our lives. There are so many other signs of Christmas, but I wanted to share with you a sign of Christmas that comes personally from my own background. And I'm going to show you something that I have here in the bag. It's been in my family for a very long time. Do you know what those are? Well, you know they're bells, but do you know what they're from?
No.
No?
A belt store? Yeah, it looks like a belt.
It does look like a belt, doesn't it? But it's from something called a harness. Does that give you any indication where it might be?
It's what cows wear.
Well, cows do. I'll give you a hint where this one comes from.
Santa?
No, it's not Santa. A horse, you're right. A long time ago, and my mother used to tell me this story, when she was a little girl, there was a lot of snow, even more snow than today, a lot of snow. So people had big sleighs like this one that they would get in and one horse. So it was called a one-horse open sleigh. Ever heard those words before?
Yeah.
Where?
In a song.
What song?
Jingle
Bells, that's right. And she told me that they, when it was really snowy, her father would hook up the horse, and they put the horse on, and whenever the horse moved, the bells would ring. And that was a real sign of joy to my mother a long time ago. These bells belonged at least to my grandparents and maybe my great-grandparents, so they're well over 100 years old. And every year, I get them out so that I can see them and hear them ring. And that brings joy to my Christmas. And I think bells, lots of bells around. Any bells in your house for decorations? And lots of people have bells. How many people have bells in their house for decorations? Look at that. See? Yeah, lots of bells, because they remind us, too, of the joy of Christmas. And so I thought this morning that we might sort of remember that joy and the bells ringing and sing Jingle Bells. We're going to sing the chorus and then the Dashing Through the Snow verse and then the chorus. And if you don't know all the words, just pretend you do, because they'll know them and they'll sing them, okay? But I wondered if you'd like to hold that end. You want to hold this end? Here? You're going to need to move closer. And when we're singing it, if you could shake it so we can hear the bell. Want to give it a try? A little more. Right. Good, so people can hear, okay? You're going to be the horses, okay? Okay, so, Ruth, if we can start.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride one horse open sleigh. Hey! Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one horse open sleigh. Dashing through the snow in a one horse open sleigh. O'er the fields we go, laughing all the way. Bells on all tail ring, making spirits bright. It is to ride and sing and sing song tonight.
So hopefully when you hear bells ring, you'll get that joy in your heart for this time of the year. Let's pray. Gracious and gracious and loving God, we thank you for this wonderful time of the year, this time of the year that brings so much joy into our hearts. May we be able to remember the ringing bells and go out and share that joy with others in this wonderful season. We ask it in your name. Amen. Have a great time upstairs.
Our first reading this morning is found in Isaiah chapter 35, verses 1 to 10. The voiceless break into song. Wilderness and desert will sing joyously. The badlands will celebrate and flower. Like the crocus in the spring, bursting into blossom, a symphony of song and color. Mountain glories of Lebanon, a gift. Awesome Carmel, stunning Sharon. Gifts. God's resplendent glory fully on display. God awesome, God majestic. Energize the limp hands, strengthen the rubbery knees. Tell fearful souls, courage, take heart. God is here, right here, on his way to put things right and redress all wrongs. He's on his way, he'll save you. Blind eyes will be opened. Deaf ears unstopped. Lame men and women will leap like deer. The voiceless break into song. Springs of water will burst out in the wilderness. Streams flow in the desert. Hot sands will become a cool oasis. Thirsty ground, a splashing fountain. Even lowly jackals will have water to drink, and barren grasslands flourish richly. There will be a highway called the Holy Road. No one rude or rebellious is permitted on this road. It's for God's people exclusively. Impossible to get lost on this road. Not even fools can get lost on it. No lions on this road. No dangerous animals. Nothing and no one dangerous or threatening. Only the redeemed will walk on it. The people God has ransomed will come back to this road. They'll sing as they make their way home to Zion, unfading halos of joy encircling their heads. Welcomed home with gifts of joy and gladness as all sorrows and sighs scurry into the night.
Our second reading is taken from the Gospel according to Matthew, the 11th chapter, starting to read at verse 2. John, meanwhile, had been locked up in prison. When he got wind of what Jesus was doing, he sent his own disciples to ask, "Are you the one we've been waiting for, or are we still waiting?" Jesus told them, "Go back and tell John what's going on. The blind see, the lame walk. Lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the wretched of the earth learn that God is on their side. Is this what you were expecting? Then count yourselves most blessed." When John's disciples left to report, Jesus started talking to the crowd about John. "What did you expect when you went to see him in the wild? A weekend camper? Hardly. What then? A sheik in silk pajamas? Not in the wilderness, not by a long shot. What then? A prophet? That's right, a prophet. Probably the best prophet you'll ever hear. He is the prophet that Malachi announced when he wrote, "I am sending my prophet ahead of you to make the road smooth for you." Let me tell you what's going on here. No one in history surpasses John the Baptizer. But in the kingdom he prepared you for, the lowliest person is ahead of him. Herein is wisdom. Thanks be to God. Well, he's back. John the Baptizer shows up for a second week. But it just doesn't seem to be the same John, does it? You brood of snakes, who invited you to slither up here? Repent, turn yourselves around, do what's right or you'll end up in the fire. Well, not this time. It appears at this point that John has lost his wilderness confidence. He is in prison, having managed to outrage the most powerful man in Israel. Prison in Jesus' time was not a pleasant place. In fact, it was a very lonely place. That's why the biblical line about visiting prisoners is so profound. A visitor meant human contact, perhaps a meal, perhaps messages from loved ones, perhaps even a hope of release. It also meant long periods of time to think. It seems that John has had time to develop some doubts. He sends his disciples to Jesus and asks his questions of doubt. Did I get it right? Did I get it right? Injustice, cruelty, and oppression linger on. Are you the one who is to come, the Messiah? How long do we have to wait? You see, this was not the Messiah for whom they had been waiting. They waited for a military leader to throw off the oppression of Rome, a powerful leader of might. Even today, Jewish people will say, well, Jesus was all right, but not the Messiah for whom we wait. Jesus doesn't directly answer John. He suggests there is a reality breaking through if you look in the right places. The blind see, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the wretched of the earth learn that God is on their side. Look again, John. Do you see it? Well, are these not our wonderings too? For 2,000 years we've been waiting, and yet injustice, cruelty, oppression thrive. Looking around the world, it's hard to be convinced that God is on the side of the wretched. Ask the people of Somalia. Be patient, we're told. Wait. Something is blooming where you thought everything was lost. Really? In the midst of this traumatic and turbulent world, where in Ukraine, Russia drops bombs on Ukraine citizens, killing innocent children. A world where God's people scramble from one place to another as refugees, seeking a safe place to lay their head. Many have been born into this life and continue in it in their adult life. Our neighbors to the south endure a political climate where words of hate and misogyny rail in a way that we once thought was impossible. Climate change is leaving farmland barren, animal habitats destroyed, storms are raging around us. And then comes this word from the scripture. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom like a crocus. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. How are we in our time to see this word? Can you see it? You will recognize these words from Handel's Messiah, if not from the Bible. Then shall the eyes of the blind be open and the ears of the deaf unstopped. How do these promises sound to people who live with disabilities? Perhaps we're looking in the wrong places. Perhaps we are so worn down we can't see the light. Here's a modern update on that passage I just shared with you. Then shall the blind woman and her dog process with the choir. The deaf man who sees what we often miss shall paint the text on the sanctuary walls. The veteran in the wheelchair will break the bread of life. And the homeless man who cannot speak shall sign the hymns for everyone else to see. Can you see it? Perhaps we're looking in the wrong places. The story is told of a Christmas Eve service in a homeless shelter. The leader noticed a man waving and pointing to himself. He could neither hear nor speak and was normally reserved. There was a hush as he stepped in front of the creche, bowed his head, turned to face the community of his contemporaries, and began to sign a carol. It was beautiful, like a dance. The notion of abled and disabled was turned upside down. It was a glimpse of God's community as the hands of the speechless were singing for joy. As the hands of the speechless were singing for joy. The book of Isaiah dares to speak a word out of place, a word that refused to wait until things improved. Walter Brueggemann reminds us, Isaiah's doxologies are characteristically against all the data. We see and hear the data every night on the news and every morning on the front page of the paper. Add to that the data of our own lives, waiting for test results from the doctor, mourning the death of a loved one, wondering if we'll make it through the recession. We know the data too well, and we long for a word out of place. A woman named Marion Wright Smith often spoke that word. After the latest defeat of a gun control measure in the United States Senate, she wrote such a word. I wake up every morning thinking of one of my role models, a brilliant, indomitable former slave woman who could neither read nor write, but who was passionate about ending slavery and the second-class treatment of women. At the end of one of her anti-slavery talks, a man came up to her and said, "Old woman, do you think your talk about slavery does any good? Do you suppose people care what you say? Why, I don't care any more for your talk than I do for the bite of a flea." "Perhaps not," she said. "But the Lord willing, I'll keep you itching." I have no expectation that some great miracle will turn the world around and bring it to its senses. I'm not so naive that I think the tragedy and trouble near and far will cease. But I do believe that change can come about as long as some people speak that word out of place. Speaking words of hope, peace, joy, and love, where they act in ways that inspire forgiveness and reconciliation. Words that let the light in. Words like Leonard Cohen's, "Ring the bell that still can ring, forget your perfect offering. There's a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in."
The birds, they sing at the break of day. "Start again," I heard them say. "Don't dwell on what has passed away or what is yet to be. Yeah, the war, they will be fought again. The holy dove, she will be cut again. Bought and sold and bought again. The dove is never free. Ring the bell that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. Signs, the signs were sent. The birth betrayed, the marriage spent. Yeah, the widowhood of every government. Signs were all to see. I can't run no more with that high places say their prayers out loud. But they've summoned up a thundercloud. They're gonna hear from me. Ring the bell, let's still ring. You can add up the parts, you won't have the sum. You can strike up the march, there is no drum. Every heart to love will come, but like a refugee. Ring the bell, let's stay.
Advent hope. We need to acknowledge the cracks in our world and then affirm that it is through the cracks that the light gets in. Yes, the light gets in. Let that encourage us to strive for that to which we know God is calling. And the people said,
don't actually feel like speaking, kind of like the meditation moment. Thanks, Rick. Trinity Beamsville is working towards the future. As you may know, we will be having a very important congregational meeting after the service today here in the sanctuary. Council and tech will be as quick as possible in starting the meeting. However, we will need to switch up a few things. So a little patience, please. For those of you watching on the live stream, you do not need to do anything. Stay tuned in and grab a refresh of a coffee or a tea. A phone number will appear on the screen that you can call in if you have a question, and at the same number can be called or texted when it comes time to vote. 96 pounds, which, as I was told by Stuart Capel, is the number of pounds that went as white gifts to Community Care West Niagara. So thank you very much. I have been asked to mention that unfortunately the walk this Friday at 1:30 will not be happening. Stay tuned for news on when it will resume. Of course, you are more than welcome to walk around your own neighborhood and say hi to people as you pass them. Free tropical plants looking for a warm and friendly forever home. Linwell Gardens in Beamsville donated 30 plants to add joy to our holiday season. Please take a plant home and share in the joy. Thank you.
Once again, we have come to that time in the service when we offer our gifts to God. Our gifts are financial, of course, and we very much appreciate the support of those who offer financial givings to this congregation for its ministry in this community and throughout the world. Some of that comes from the financial support, and some of it comes from the actual work and travail that people do within this congregation. One very simple example of that, again, is the soup that you have been smelling. It's, again, an opportunity when someone has decided that they wanted to give of their time and talent, and all of those givings that we will be sharing with them will be going to good causes. So once again, we rejoice and give thanks for your gifts, and now we present them unto God. Gracious and loving God, we ask your blessing on these gifts that have come here to be shared in the life and the work of this congregation as we seek to be your witnesses not only here, but in places around the community and in the world. Bless those who bring the gifts as well as the givers, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. I often think that joy, unlike happiness, which kind of announces itself with a burst of, you know, in-your-face energy and that kind of thing, and maybe even noise, I think joy is different, that it comes quietly, kind of unannounced from a deeper place. Like in a personal situation, maybe after a time of darkness and struggle or waiting, or in an organization or corporate way, maybe after a time of conflict and loss of purpose. And then in a spiritual way, after a time when God seems absent. Slowly it creeps into our lives. Things begin to fall into place. There's a sense of relief, maybe renewed health, hope and peace, an awareness that God is present. That's joy. I have an equation for it today. Hope plus joy. Hope plus peace equals joy. I wonder if Mary and Joseph on their long journey to Bethlehem came to a place in the road where they stopped and looked around and said, well, we're past the midpoint and we're still safe. It's going okay. If Mary felt that babe within her getting stronger and more anxious to burst into the world, and that feeling between them, like all is well, all will be well. I think there is joy in knowing that all is well and all will be well. So hope plus peace equals joy. This morning, I want to hold up before you Zen and Loretta. For the past year, they have been on a journey to discover the cause of Zen's illness and the treatment for it. And finally, they had answers. Today, they're on their way to Toronto. They're staying at a downtown hotel overnight, and tomorrow, early tomorrow morning, Zen will have the much needed heart surgery at Toronto General Hospital. When I woke up this morning, I went down into the living room and all I could see was snow. And I immediately panicked, thinking they had to get to Toronto. I immediately went on my phone. I was looking at the weather apps in both Lincoln and Toronto and figuring the best time for them to leave was 3 p.m. this afternoon. I texted Loretta. Then I said, as an alternative, I could drive you to the GO train and you could be, that would take you into downtown Toronto. Then I wrote back and said, I don't like that option. When she told Zen about my concerns, he started to laugh. He said, this is nothing. This is not really snow. And anyways, he brought me joy by his response. But at the same time, pray for Zen. Pray for Zen and Loretta in the coming day and a half or so that all will be well, that all will be well. Unfortunately, we are living at a time when we hope for change, but it's hard to find peace when there is war and conflict in the world. And when many women and men are ill and awaiting treatment in a very stressed healthcare system, when young children are severely ill and there's a shortage of very basic drugs like Tylenol, and when there's so much disparity between those who have and those who have not. So let us now pray to the God of hope and peace, the source of joy in our lives and in the life of the world. Let us pray. God of hope, peace, and joy, we give you thanks for your ongoing presence in our lives, in our church, in our country, and in the world. We continue to pray for the people of the Ukraine. We give thanks for the hope that seems to be ingrained in them, despite the horrific assaults and bombings from Russian forces. We give thanks for the aid and support they are receiving from so many countries. We give thanks for the little times and places and glimpses where there is peace, and pray that the people can sustain themselves until the day of peace comes. We pray for those who live in countries where they too are at war or in conflict, but not receiving the same attention and support as the people of the Ukraine. May we increase our awareness of their need. We give thanks for the many places in Canada where we live in hope and peace and experience the joy of being Canadian each day. But we know that there are places where peace eludes the people of Canada yet. We think of the growing numbers of homeless people in major cities who are being evicted even from their temporary outdoor places. We give thanks for those who advocate on their behalf and for those who support and work in out-of-the-cold programs. We hold up the Indigenous women in Manitoba whose mothers have recently been brutally murdered, their bodies hidden in landfill sites. How can they have hope? What chance for peace? We pray for all who are ill and waiting for treatment or hospitalization. Especially we pray for those in our congregation who are ill, those we know, and those who are silent. We give thanks that Phyllis and Bruce are home and recovering from surgeries. We pray for Fern and for Brenda who wait, hoping for a call that treatment can begin. We pray for Zen and Aletta and Loretta making the drive to Toronto. Finally, we pray for our church as we prepare to celebrate the birth of Christ. We give thanks for the energy that so many are putting into rebuilding our congregation. We give thanks for the generosity of so many at this time of the year. And we pray that the congregational meeting about to begin will fill us with the hope and peace of mind and direction that will lead us to a newer way of being the church. We pray that the soup lunch which follows the meeting will fill our bodies with strength for our journey as we eat it and fill our spirits with hope and peace and joy as we share it. We pray in the name of the Christ child, whose presence is with us and within us now and forever. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. And together, let us offer this historic prayer, which has grounded the Christian community for 2,000 years and more. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
I wish that I could acknowledge the piece that I want to share with you now, but I can't. It's one of the things that I've picked up in many years of ministry that had no author attached. So anyway, I cannot tell you how the light comes. What I know is that it is more ancient than imagining, that it travels across an astounding expanse to reach us, that it loves searching out what is hidden, what is lost, what is forgotten or in peril or in pain, that it has a fondness for the body, for finding its way toward flesh, for tracing the edges of form, for shining forth through the eye, the hand, the heart. I cannot tell you how the light comes, but that it does, that it will, that it works its way into the deepest dark that enfolds you, though it may seem long ages in coming or arrive in a shape you did not foresee. And so, may we this day turn ourselves toward it. May we lift our faces to let it find us. May we bend our bodies to follow the arc it makes. May we open and open more and open still to the blessed light that comes. And so, for this day, in the spirit of John the Evangelist and John the Baptist, a simple blessing and a prayer, that we may tell the story, that we may testify to the light, that the word may take flesh in us this day and in the days to come. Go now in joy, and the blessing of God, our Creator, our Redeemer, and our Sustainer, be with you now and remain with you always. Amen.